So yeah, I mean, I think that there's all the information that you need. Just to remind everybody, this is our review of everything to do with supply and demand. So all the questions that you see on the supply and demand analytics and all the questions you see under the price control homework and all the questions that you see on taxes and subsidies homework, they're all on the exam. Well, or eligible to be on the exam, I should say. Now, I will give you guys one hint, and that is if you see a question that's especially simple, like, what's the equilibrium price? Chances are on the exam, that would be a very low probability to show up on the exam. So, in general, it's the questions that are kind of towards the end of the assignments, the ones that expect you to actually be able to work with and do several different things at once that are more likely to be on the exam. So, does anybody have any questions for me? Questions? No questions? Okay. Going once, going twice, gone. Okay. So I'm going to stop sharing and then we'll go back to our lecture. Okay. And I also, I guess, by way of the exam, to remind you, and I'll post this on Blackboard and send out on an announcement, but we'll be starting the exam like we did last time, in between like the two classes, so we have enough time that everybody can get everything submitted at the end. After they actually finish the exam. So we'll do it in exactly the same format that we did the practice exam. Okay. So last time, let's see here if I can draw this. So last time we talked about the consumer optimization problem. And we're going to continue on talking about the consumer optimization problem. And remember, the consumer optimization problem has these two considerations. One is the budget, which is what's affordable. We talked about affordability last time. And the other one is the preferences of consumers. Now, under preferences, we started out kind of simply and we said, okay, well, we know that the consumer is rational. And among other things, that means that they're monotonic. And our observation was, well, gosh, monotonicity is actually pretty powerful. Because once we know the consumer's budget constraint, and remember, we've got the quantity of one good, I'll actually just call it X1 there, and of another good. Before we called this the Y good, but I'm calling it X2 for right now, just to see that. It doesn't matter. We call them X and Y. We can call them different things. Now I'm going to revert to the other notation because I just think it's helpful right now to refer to this one as good Y because it'll remind you it's the X and Y axes and that sort of thing. And then we said, well, we can graph this budget constraint. We can figure out its slope. And this one is going to be budget divided by PY. and the horizontal intercept down here is going to be the budget divided by the price of x. Okay, so everything looks pretty good. And so we said that everything, including the budget line or the budget constraint and below the budget line, is what's affordable to the consumer. And all of the consumption bundles or points here in the consumption space that are outside of it are unaffordable. And we know the consumer is monotonic, so they prefer to get more of both goods, right? And so we said, because we know they're monotonic, we know that ultimately they're going to end up choosing some point on their budget line. One of these are going to be what we call the consumers. And I'll just illustrate one example. Okay. So for example, some point like this that lays on the actual budget line. This is going to be, and I'll use a little different color. Some point like this is going to be what we call the consumer's optimal consumption bundle. Okay. And let's see. Miriam, are you here today? I haven't heard your voice in a while. Well, I assume you're here. You just signed on. You have a mic? No. Okay. Let's see. How about Sarah? Sarah and Grainy?
Yes.
How are you doing?
I'm okay.
You're okay. Okay. So did you follow everything that I've said so far?
I just signed in. Sorry.
Yeah. Well, this is from last time too. I don't know if you watched the video, but we have this line we're calling the consumption or the budget constraint. And I'm just illustrating the consumer because they have what we call the monotonic preferences, will choose some point on the budget constraint. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So remember that, Sarah, this is what we're calling, and we have called, and I'll put it down here, the consumer choice problem. Okay. So we're asking the question, if the consumer chooses between two goods, right, and has a budget, what will they ultimately choose to consume? Okay, does that make sense?
Can you say it again?
Yeah, so this is an illustration of the consumer choice problem. And what the consumer choice problem is the problem that every consumer faces. Do you have a budget? I'm asking you, Sarah.
Yeah.
You have a budget, right?
Yeah.
And you have to decide what you're going to buy with a budget.
Yes.
Right. I mean, I'm assuming that's true. And so you have all these choices of what to buy, and you have to figure out what ultimately to buy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so this is an example of your budget, right? It's your budget constraint, and this is everything you can afford, any of these points in here. And ultimately you choose one. And I guess the reason why I'm talking with you, Sarah, is that one problem that a lot of students face at the end, even if they follow the math, is interpreting what happened. And so, because, you know, this is just two goods, And I talked with Sonika last time about this, okay, X and Y. It's very abstract. And we could put labels on them. Like we could say, you know, this is tacos. And this is up here, will this one be tequila, right? Y could be tequila. But sometimes students also find that that's kind of even abstract for them because they never see themselves in this situation. So I'll ask you, Sarah, do you ever choose how much how many tacos and how much tequila to purchase? Are you there, Sarah?
Yeah.
You do. Yeah. You're there. You do choose how much tacos and tequila.
Yeah, I choose tacos.
Well, yeah, but do you choose only tacos?
Yeah, sometimes if.
Yeah. Okay. Well, what do you drink when you have tacos?
Like soda.
Soda. Okay. So you're choosing some combination of tacos. And in your case, soda.
Okay.
I think tequila sounds more exciting.
Yeah.
but yeah, so tacos and soda, right? But when you finish making that choice, you end up like having, I don't know, how many tacos you typically eat?
Four. Well, it depends on the size.
Depends on the size. Okay. But let's just go with that. We'll just say they're like the little street tacos. Okay.
Yeah.
And so on the taco axis, that your point, if this was your optimal consumption bundle, would be four, right? And how many sodas you typically have?
One.
Okay. So, and then over here, now it doesn't have to be the scale. It doesn't matter, meaning that you know, this is one and that's four and this looks closer to zero, so you know, but still for you this is fine because it's just an illustration. Yeah, this would be your optimal consumption bundle. You get one soda and four tacos. And the reason why I bring it up, Sarah, is that I want you to remember that this model is supposed to be predicting what you actually do.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's supposed to be prediction of human behavior. And and sometimes students lose the math is supposed to match up with reality. And a lot of times students forget that. They think, oh yeah, I can solve this math, but what does it have to do with? So I'll ask somebody else too, just to make sure I'm communicating well. So how about
okay,
Ryan Turlip? Are you there, Ryan?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. So did you follow what I was saying to Sarah?
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah, that this actually, when you're going to solve and you're going to have this, you know, set of equations and you're going to come out with an optimal consumption bundle, that optimal consumption bundle is supposed to actually predict what real human beings do. So what's Ryan's choice of... And like I said, this is an abstraction. We just have two goods. You know, in your life, Ryan, do you ever try to think in like some time period in a month, like how many goods you purchase?
Yeah, I would even factor in like rent.
Yeah, because that's housing services. That's totally, yeah. So rent and gas, those are probably two of the big ones for people. Car insurance, maybe car payment. Yeah, and then groceries, and you have all the different category, like grocery products, right? Like I just bought a product, sort of an impulse buy at target. And I really like it. So I got, maybe I'll show you my new product. Hold on, wait a minute. I'll be right back. Okay, you ready for it, Ryan?
I'm ready.
Trident Vibes Tropical Heat. Yes.
That's not a huge impulse buy.
Well, I was looking for gum, and for a while I was kind of addicted to the little ice cubes. They're like marshmallows. And then I was like, "Bah, but these are too sweet." And they're a little bit too mushy, and I was eating them like candy, which I'm sure is the intent of the manufacturer. And then I was like, nah, you know, I want something that's a little bit less like candy. And so I tried the Trident Vibes, and the ones that I normally get are like the mint flavored ones. I don't normally get like tropical flavored gum, but they were out. And I was like, you know, I'll try it. And, you know, I think it's very nice. So, but the point is that, yeah, you have all of these things that are in your consumption space. And, you know, your ultimate consumption bundle for the month is going to be this. So, Ryan, how much math have you taken? Have you taken calculus or vector calculus or anything like that?
Yeah, I've taken some calculus.
Yeah, well, if you took vector calculus, then like a vector is just a list of numbers. Like here we have an ordered pair, which is like your simplest example of a vector. But you could have like, you know, a three-dimensional vector, four-dimensional vector, 50-dimensional vector, right? A list of 50 numbers, each one representing a different quantity of a different good. And so like your consumption space in reality, like your consumption bundle is going to be some point in a space that is, you know, maybe has, I don't know, like 1,000 dimensions or something.
Right.
So anyway, I mean, this is our simplest version, but in truth, if we have a good model, and since we're just starting out, right, doing this kind of stuff, we keep it simple, just two, you can only consume two things, but it can easily be extended to include lots of other stuff too. So don't be fooled that because we're talking about tacos and tequila, that this doesn't match up with reality, because you never live in a world where there are only tacos and tequila. And that's really the assumption here.
Right, it's just a simplified version with two goods.
Yeah, exactly. And it's supposed to predict what Ryan Turlip would really do. If we got Ryan Turlip's budget and we know his preferences, which is saying a lot. I mean, I'm going to tell you in a minute, we're going to deal with another kind of like simplified version of preferences. And usually the way that we do this in economic modeling is you use the simplest mathematical framework. And you might say, well, why are we using math? Well, because we want to measure stuff and be precise. At the end of the day, you're either going to buy however many units of Trident Vibes or not. It's a number, right? And we're interested in calculating the allocation of resources, which resources are measured in units, you know, how many, you know, tons of sugar, how many gallons of gasoline. So we're dealing with numbers. So it makes sense we have these quantitative models, because that's what we want to predict, you know, how much gasoline is going to be produced and sold in the state of California, for example. You want to be able to do economic forecasting that's meaningful. You want to say, when some policy comes in, how is that going to affect the quantity of different goods and services? So we need these mathematical models to make these quantitative predictions. But the idea is to make the model as simple as possible to capture the reality. And so when we start introducing these things, it may seem like we're doing something complex, but it's only because something simpler just won't do the job. So also, I guess I'll point out where we ended up last time, which was when we had this sort of simplified version of preferences, we always said what monotonicity basically means is that we have a preference direction in this two-dimensional space. And I'll actually put it in a different color. I'll use red. So the consumer always wants to move toward this northeasterly direction. Okay. And do you get that, Ryan? Because they always just want to get more stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's weakly northeasterly. And that's kind of like our monotonicity puts us northeasterly, but notice also that there's nothing wrong with going like this or like
more
that.
Tacos.
Yeah. Like if you're like, it just has to be northeasterly. Now, the one thing I did accidentally for a minute is I went like that. No. That means less X and more Y. No. Or less Y and more X. No, we wouldn't do that. We're gonna be confined to this. It has to be north and east. It could be more east or more north, but it has to be northeasterly. Okay.
Gotcha.
Okay. So that's as far as we can get with monotonicity. So the one other thing that we said is we said that when preferences are monotonic, then they also admit a utility function representation. And so what do I mean by that? Well, you guys are going to learn pretty quickly that talking about preferences generally, like I said, it doesn't get us very far in our analysis. It doesn't move us towards a more quantitative model that we can use for prediction, at least not very easily. What economists have found out, and there are proofs of this and the rest of it, is that you can come up with a utility function that captures preferences as long as the preferences are rational. Okay. So what does the utility function do generally? Well, suppose that we have two consumption bundles, A and B, and we know that A is strictly preferred to B by the consumer, okay? Well, and again, preference just means they like it more. We don't know how much more, just they like it more. If they're given a choice between A and B, they would choose A and not B. Well, the existence of a utility function means that there's some function that if you put A in that function, and that'll map to some real number, right? So I'll just say, if you guys are familiar with this notation, maps to a real number. Okay. And if we put B in the utility function, that'll also map to some real number. Okay. And by saying that it's a real number, you guys should remember back from, I don't know. So I have a daughter right now that's in the eighth grade, and she's taking algebra one. And then in seventh grade, she took, like pre-algebra math. And they taught her all about the integers and the real numbers and rational numbers and things like that. But basically, we just mean that it could be any number, including numbers that can't be represented as a fraction that's finite. So things like pi, right, are fine. That's a real number. Infinitely non-repeating decimals. But just numbers like you guys could see all the numbers on the real number line, such that, if we have properly represented the preferences with the utility function such that if you represents the consumer's preferences, then U, the number U of A, will be greater than the number U of B. So, for example, and there can be lots of different representations. There's not one, it's not unique. In fact, this is what we call an ordinal preference relation, or it's an ordering, right? So for example, if we say U of A is equal to 10, then U of B could be equal to anything less than 10, 9.99. Or, you know, maybe it'd be simpler to say U is equal to 5. So now I know, right, that the consumer, since they're always, they have this ordering based on this utility function, this numbering of all of these consumption bundles, then what you hear a lot of times is that the consumption choice problem, or the consumer's choice problem, is equivalent to a utility maximization problem. And so now we have our new formulation, okay? And our new formulation is that now we're gonna use this language where instead of talking about the consumer's choice, we'll automatically say, oh, this is, you know, the consumer's utility maximization problem, but we mean the same thing, that the consumer is going to choose the consumption bundle with the highest possible utility, given that it's affordable. Does that make sense, Ryan? Are you following me?
Yeah, I'm following.
Okay. So now if you hear me say utility maximization problem instead of the consumer choice problem, it shouldn't give you any like real pause. We had to take some steps to get there, but now that we've taken those steps, those two concepts are equivalent. So what does the consumer's utility maximization problem look like? Well, let's just talk about utility functions for a minute. And I think probably the easiest way to talk about utility functions is to just give an example. And so again, let's just suppose that the consumer can only get one good, or we're just looking at their preferences in one dimension, right? X is the only good being considered. Okay. So then, you know, one common way of doing this, and I'll move this over here, is to say, okay, we're going to give, and you don't have to do this, right? You could actually, for each and every amount of X, right? And let's just say, you know, okay, Ryan, I'll go back to you since you were chatting with me. What do you want X to be? It could be anything. It could be Trident Vibes. It could be beer. It could be.
Let's do beer.
Okay, okay. Do you have a favorite beer?
Whatever's cheapest for me now. So.
Oh, no. No. No.
Well, we got a budget, you know?
Yeah, no. No, so, I used to tell stories about my hard drinking cousin, and so he's now he's retired, but he used to do physical labor construction work. He used to build swimming pools, and I was living with my aunt while I was going to college, and he's my aunt's son. So he would get up, you know, super early, like 4 o'clock in the morning every day. And because most of that type of work is work that you want to do before it gets hot. So every time I would come home from school in the afternoon, he would already be home from work. And he'd have a 12-pack of beer, and he'd be playing some sports football game on the you know, at that time it was the Nintendo, you know, and like Madden football type thing. And I didn't really drink much beer back then, and I noticed that every single day I would come home, and he would have like a different 12-pack, sometimes Coors Light, sometimes Old Milwaukee, sometimes whatever. And so one time I said to him, I'm like, hey, don't you have like a favorite beer? And he said, just what you said. My favorite beer is whatever's cheapest. And I'm polar opposite of that. I'm a beer snob. So I have very particular tastes in beer. So we'll just let your beer be the silver bullet. But the point is, right? So I could ask you, and I don't know. So Ryan, are you like my hard drinking cousin? Are you you know, are you 12 pack a day, or are you more?
No, not quite.
okay. I met, he was kind of a little bit on the extreme end, and a lot of people would have said my cousin's an alcoholic. I'm not gonna dispute that one way or the other, but I'll just say that he was functional, and you know, culture is different. You know, there are lots of people,
right?
You know, in Europe, that like when I lived in the Netherlands, like their culture is different, and you know, drinking every single day was totally normal for them. So whatever, you know, no judgment from me. So yeah, he you know, he got up to work and he went to work every day and he did a good job and all that other stuff, and he never got a DUI, so he was okay. But yeah, so I would ask you, okay, so on a scale of 1 to 10, because we just have to put a limit on it, it could be any number, but let's say on a scale of 1 to 10, it's hot day. I don't know when you normally drink. You know, I would drink around dinner time. You know, it's not uncommon for me to not have a beer with dinner. That's pretty common. But you know, you can imagine yourself in your optimal drinking scenario. I don't know if that's barbecue or whatever. Barbecue, hot day, friends around. On a scale of 1 to 10, how much do you, and I don't know about you, I'm also very sensitive about the temperature of my beer. I like my beer to be very cold in most cases. Do you have a beer temperature preference? What's your best beer temperature?
Really cold if I'm, you know, enjoying it, but okay, a little bit warmer if I'm chugging it.
Oh, okay. Well, so you have to tell us, is this a chugging scenario or not? What's your optimal beer drinking scenario, Ryan?
Optimal in terms of like enjoyment?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, I would say, you know, like you said, smoking like a tri-tip or something, enjoying like some ice cold beer on the back porch or something like that.
Okay, okay. So we're on the same page. So your first beer, and obviously it's noon somewhere, as you're cooking your tri-tip, on a scale of 1 to 10, how assuming you're thirsty, that how much do you enjoy that first beer?
Probably like a 9 or 10.
9 or 10. Okay. And also, and you can assume however you want to do this, right? Whatever's like best for you. For me, I'm actually like 2 beers to 1 bottle of water type person, because if I need to pace myself a little bit. But so for the second beer on a scale of 1 to 10, how do you feel about that?
Honestly, I'd probably still be rocking like an 8 or 9.
Okay, but a little bit less than the first one. Okay, and what about the third beer?
It would probably go down incrementally by like 1 or 2 until like the 4th or 5th.
Till you fell. Because you didn't drink them anymore. Okay, good point. All right, so I just want to point out to everybody one thing that you talked about. You illustrated a concept that economists call diminishing marginal utility, which means if you ever get confused by the word marginal, and there's a technical definition for marginal, I think I've told you guys this before, but I'll remind you now here because it's important. Marginal means additional. That's as close as you can get to it. The technical definition is it's the derivative of the utility function. So it's an infinitesimal change, right? It's an incremental, tiny, tiny, tiny increment of whatever you're talking about, in this case, a change in the amount of beer you're consuming. But the way that most people think about it, it's the amount your utility would change if you were to increase your consumption by 1 unit, in this case, 1 extra beer. And notice that Ryan's additional utility was going down. So at first he was at a 9 or 10, and then he went to like 9 or 8, and then like an 8, and he's like, okay, it's going to go down a little bit each time I have an additional beer. And that's an additional assumption beyond rationality, but it's typical that economists assume that consumers have diminishing marginal utility. So sometimes you might see a caveat. We're talking about well-behaved preferences, so not strictly rational. This is beyond rationality. And so rational preferences can have diminishing marginal utility, but there are some non-diminishing marginal utility examples that are also rational. So I'll give you one other quick example, and let's see. Derek, are you here today?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, I only ask you because I know that I can't. I won't offend you easily. at least I'm assuming I won't. I feel like, you know, I know you pretty well. And you're like, not that well, Dr. Hunter, not that well. Okay. Well, so can you think of anything where you don't have diminishing marginal utility? And so that would mean as you consume more of it, like your desire to consume more of it goes up. Well, okay. How about
some like medication?
How about like heroin?
Well, I was gonna say like drugs.
Yeah. How about crack?
Yeah, that's what came to mind was drugs.
So there are things that it's pretty easy to argue that as people get more of it, they get addicted. And, you know, so like heroin and crack and things like that. So the only reason why I'm pointing it out Derek, is because I don't know. Have you done your senior seminar project yet?
That's you're going to do next semester.
Next semester, yeah. Okay, so, but if you're thinking about doing a senior seminar project and you wanted to do one on like crime and drugs or something like that, then you might, you know, encounter a model where, again, preferences are rational. They're complete monotonic and transitive, but they don't have diminishing marginal utility. And there's nothing that says we have to have the diminishing margin utility. It just turns out if we don't have diminishing margin utility, we got to be careful. So it's important to think about a couple of these examples just so people don't get fooled into believing that, oh no, like everything is diminishing margin utility, because it's not. So yeah. Okay.
That makes sense.
Okay, good. So, but when we say well-behaved preferences, then usually what we're adding on is this diminishing marginal utility assumption. So that's really common. Now, So we could do what we did with Ryan, and we could just say, hey, you know, we're just gonna come up with a list, and every time you tell me how much beer you're gonna drink, tell me what number you assign to it. That's kind of tedious. And so usually what we do is we'll say, the utility of X in this case, and we're going to give it some algebraic function that we're familiar with. I'll give you guys one that's really commonly used. That's the square root function of X, right? And it's because we're dealing with strictly positive quantities, and so we don't have to worry about anything that's less than zero. And if you look at the graph of the square root function, okay, we all know the square root of zero is zero, and this is going to be the amount of X, and this is going to be U of X. And let me try to do a good job of drawing this. Okay, that should be smooth, and it gets flatter and flatter, but it's always increasing. So it looks about like that. Okay. And this is, I want to point out, this is the total utility, right? Marginal utility of X is du dx, right? And again, if you guys recognize this, the change in utility over the change in X, and it's also the derivative of the utility function with respect to X. That's all fine. But if we're going to look at that at any given point, so let's say, okay, suppose we're going to look at, my point's not very good. Okay, so okay, Derek, are you still with me?
Yeah.
Okay. So the slope of this tangent line at that point, is the slope of the function. And that's actually the margin of utility. And so can you see, like, if I pick a different point down here, that the margin of utility down at the lower point, since it's steeper, it's going to be a bigger number.
Yeah.
So yeah, this function represents well-behaved preferences in one dimension. We have high margin of utility and then lower margin of utility. And then if we measure the slope over here, it'd be even lower. So margin of utility is the slope. And so maybe I'll do just one of the thing with this picture. So okay. And let's see. Okay. So okay. So this is the way that a utility function looks in one dimension. But you know, our consumer optimization problem, to be really clear about this, okay. So again, you with me, Derek?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So if I was to ask you, okay, here is X, and we know the price of X. So the maximum amount of X that the consumer can afford is pretty easy. It's just going to be some point here. Okay, that's the maximum, right? All of from zero to that point there is affordable. And this is unaffordable, more than that point. That makes sense, Derek?
Yep.
And then I ask, well, what? How much X will the consumer choose to purchase? What's your answer? Now, remember, we're assuming there's only X, right? Mm-hmm. You might consider this, and I don't know. How do you feel about beer, Derek?
I like beer.
Do you have a favorite beer?
If you tell me I have a couple. So I like Pliny the Elder, which is an IPA, and then I like, it's a few different Belgians I enjoy.
Okay, well, yeah, you know, I'm off the IPAs, but if you're like my nephews, they, you know, they drink that stuff like it's lemonade. So
one or two of those, and then I'm done with them.
I don't like my beer to bite me back.
Right.
And the IPAs, that's what they do to me. So okay, but so this is a super abstract example. So the question is that's really being asked here is, so imagine this is heaven, okay? There's beer and only beer available to purchase. And I don't know if that's your idea of heaven or not, but I'm just trying to be true to what the model's asking, because I think it's easier if you really understand what the model's supposing, what are the assumptions. So we only have X here that we can purchase. So, and you can afford 0, 1, 2, 3, and then your maximum number of units. I don't know what that is. Does it help if we put a number on it?
I don't need a number.
Okay. So the question is then, how much do you purchase?
And if there's only one good,
yeah,
I would assume I'm going to purchase the max amount I can afford if I'm only worried about one good.
Yeah, exactly. So bing, that's your optimal consumption bundle. And the reason why I'm going through all of this is because this is what your budget constraint, I mean, if you were going to draw it, I mean, it's actually a point, but we could draw it as like a line, mm-hmm. right? And so that's your budget constraint, and there's only one good to purchase. You could say like everything else in life is free and you only have to buy beer, right? So if you only have to buy one thing, then you're just going to buy as much beer as you can. And why? Because look, right, your utility keeps going up as you get more and more beer, right? Yeah. So if you're going to maximize your utility, you're going to max out by buying the maximum amount of beer. If your utility function looked different, you wouldn't be maximizing your utility. If, for example, this is not the case, right? Because these would be non-monotonic preferences. But suppose for a minute, and I'm going to erase this. Okay, Jacob, what type of water do you prefer? Do you have water preferences? Okay. Did Jacob? Oh, Kirkland brand. See, you could have at least made it more exciting. Like, what's the one that comes from the volcano? Okay, but suppose now instead that your utility function looked like this, right, Derek?
Okay, yeah.
Right, so now you see, right, your maximum is somewhere in the middle.
It's like at that apex right there.
Yeah, and then if you get so try to walk through me this scenario. And again, you know, this is why you have to kind of be careful about your analysis, right? This is zero beer. And now your utility is going up and up and up. And then you're like, oh, I've got the best buzz going, right?
Yep.
Right? After I don't know how many, right, bottles or ounces of beer, right? But then, you're drinking more, and what's happening?
Yeah, and now your utility's going down, or in layman terms, you're getting drunk, you're getting...
You just fell down.
It's like, now you're just wasting beer at that point.
Yeah, or it's going down and coming back up.
Yeah.
Right? So this is maybe what Ryan was talking about when he was like in the chugging mode, right? Yeah, so you're right, Sonica. I was thinking about Fiji water. But so the main point is, yeah, you could imagine some sort of scenario where you could have negative marginal utility, right? And you could actually be worse off as you consume more. And actually, there's a special name in economics. And maybe you like this, Derek. So this point here, which is the peak, right, of this utility function, you know what they call that? They call that the bliss point. So you know what I mean by bliss?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like where you your maximum possible utility. And then if you consume more, you go down. But I want to point out something, and that is that in standard economics, under the assumption of rationality, we rule out bliss points. Now, I'm not saying that none of our analysis would work if we had bliss points, we had utility functions that looked like the green. It's sort of like a parabola, right? But we rule them out. And it's because we don't want to deal with, you know, these edge cases. But again, if you're working on a senior seminar project and for some reason you think that you're talking about something like maybe, you know, binge drinking behavior of college students where they drink too much and they get sick, you might argue that, well, you know, now we've got a utility function that looks like this green one and not the red one that's always going up and up. Okay. Any questions, Derek?
No.
Okay. Okay. So, but the problem is, so this example that I just gave you is utility in just one dimension. And as long as we've assumed rationality, the choice, you know, the analysis is super simple. If agents are monotonic, they just choose to consume the maximum, done. It's over with, right? And we don't have this issue of like, oh, they're two goods, and there's a trade-off between them. And if prices changed a little bit, I might buy a little bit more of one, a little bit less of another. So we're not capturing very much that's interesting about consumer behavior with this super simple model. So we need the choice model to include at least two goods. Okay. So Sonika, are you there this morning?
Yeah.
Okay. So see if you follow me here. So we're going to have utility functions that have two goods, and actually, so are you utility function, and see if this makes sense to you, is going to be a three-dimensional graph. Okay. So I don't know if you've seen this let me check my time. Okay. So this would be the X dimension, and this would be the Y dimension, and this would be, generally we would call this the Z dimension, right? But can you see how the z-axis, and maybe I'll, and on the z-axis in our case, we're gonna graph u, the utility. But can you see how it's the case that this z-axis, like, it's like the corner of a box? That makes sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you've seen those types of graphs before.
Yeah, I've seen them. I just haven't seen them with utility functions.
Yeah.
But I've seen them in like calc and all that stuff.
Okay, good. So our basic example for a utility function, the one that's used most frequently in economics is the utility of two goods X and Y is going to be equal to X raised to the A power, we say alpha, times Y raised to the B power.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if this helps better. Okay. And then I'm going to say where A plus B is equal to 1. There's one other caveat, and that is, and A and B are positive. So I'll give you another example. This is like a concrete example. So an example of this type of function is u of x and y, that's our z variable, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is equal x raised to the 1/2 power,
yeah,
times y raised the 1/2 power. Yeah. So this is a really common example And so, again, it's not like we couldn't just do a simple list, right? So if I knew that X is tacos and Y is tequila, I could just, and I'm trying to figure out what Sonica's utility function is, then, you know, one way I could do that is I could just say, okay, let's make a list. Okay. And this is a little bit like a magic trick, because do you like tacos and tequila, Sonica?
I like tacos and water, but yeah, I love tacos.
Everybody likes tacos. See, and it's hard for me. It's hard for me because depending, you guys take this class in your junior year. Some people might be 21. Some mm-hmm. people might not be. And then whether or not you like tequila after you're 21 is kind of like, you know, it depends. You know, so I have a son that I think I told you guys about. He's living in the Czech Republic right now. And he, as far as I know, but also he's a pretty honest person, didn't drink any alcohol before the age 21. Mm-hmm. And on his 21st birthday, we went out and had a beer together. He said he wanted to have his first beer with me. Since then, he's become a pretty regular consumer of alcohol.
Oh.
You
kind of started this.
Yeah, blame it on me if you want. Fine. I'm just glad he waited till he was 21. I didn't have to worry about him in college, because he graduated just before or right after his 21st birthday, like really close.
Yeah.
Because he had a bunch of AP credits and all that other stuff.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I didn't have to worry about him, you know, having trouble in college, so that was fine with me. Now I worry a little bit. But yeah, his tastes are pretty wide and varied, you know. He likes hard liquor and he likes beer and doesn't really drink much wine. Mm-hmm. But yeah, some people, you know, never like really get a taste. But I will tell you one thing, not like I'm trying to promote alcohol use here, yeah. But just a personal observation of mine, which I told my son, is that, hey, listen, you know, actually quality does matter. You'd be surprised. But in, you know, my humble opinion, usually when you see something and it's like a lot more expensive in alcohol, it tastes better and you can tell the difference in the quality. So I would say that, you know, if people have had like cheap tequila, they probably just aren't really getting the tequila experience.
Yeah.
So anyway, but I could ask you, so you want to pick two other goods. It doesn't have to be tacos and tequila. Are there two things that you like? You can put clothes and shoes or...
I can't think of anything. Like my mind is blank, and only thing I'm thinking about is tacos and tequila.
Yeah, yeah. So I should. We should do like. So, what do you want for
your
birthday? What
are your two other favorite things?
Well, you know, favorite things. That's hard. Yeah, it's kind of like one of those things that I don't know if you remember when you were a little kid. That mm-hmm. people would ask you what's your favorite color, your favorite number, and you'd always have one. Like, oh yeah, my favorite color is blue, my favorite color is red, you know, mm-hmm. my favorite number is 3. But when you get older and people ask you your favorite color, normally that stuff kind of goes away. You're like, you know, I kind of like red, but I think blue is nice too, and you know, I really like yellow. So I think maybe I'm too old to really, you know, feel passionate about, you know, these two things. So we could just pick stuff.
Let's go into Thai food then.
Okay.
Green curry chicken versus pad thai. How about that?
Okay. Green curry chicken versus pad thai. Well, actually, yeah. So we're talking about you know, Thai food. Mm-hmm. I really like the soup, especially on a cold day.
Oh yeah.
The coconut milk soup. Yeah.
I think you're talking about tom yum soup, yeah.
Yeah.
Or tom, one of them. I don't even
yeah,
know anymore.
Yeah.
I
just right. tell them to bring so that's fine. So we can have, you know, like, but you know, it actually might even be better to do it this way and think about, so if you like Thai food, and I don't know if there's some other category like Persian food or Indian food or, you know, tacos or whatever, where you're thinking about your food budget for a month and how much you spend in each category, that might actually even work better. So you want to do Thai food and tacos?
Sure.
Okay. So Thai food and tacos. Okay. So let me see here. X equals Thai and Y equals tacos. Now notice that, again, I said this is a little bit like a magic trick because there are some unstated assumptions that kind of makes things work smoothly. Is that if you violate them, that you'll end up getting weird results without even trying too hard. And so our analysis is a static analysis, which means it takes place in a period of time. It could be an hour, a day, a week, a month, a year. But if you don't fix the time period, then you run the risk of getting confused and thinking, you know, I wouldn't eat 4 Thai meals and, you know, 50 tacos in one day. That mm-hmm. would be absurd. So let's just make it like monthly food budget between Thai and tacos, and then it will be more like reasonable. And so I could just make this list and say like, okay, so, you know, you're going to go out twice a month. You know, that's what your budget will allow. We'll assume these things cost about the same amount, just in terms of, you know, talking about things. And if you go out once to you know, tacos and wants to Thai food, then, and this is the other thing that kind of makes it work well, right? So notice that if I talk about something like the square root function, right? You may not know this, but the square root function goes toward infinity. It has no upper bound. It yeah. just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, but at a slower rate, right? And that's what monotonicity requires of us, that it always increases as we get more.
A quick question I had yeah. was, with the diminishing marginal utility graph, could it ever go past 0? Like, it's only just reaching 0, but it can never go into the negative, right? Like how it goes up and then comes down. It can never reach negative, right?
Well, if you mean that our assumption is that diminishing marginal utility, yeah, so we'll never have a negative slope like we do on the green yeah. line. Here, there's the negative slope.
But not like a negative point where like add a specific amount of X and specific amount of Y, it'll turn into a negative U about U or whatever. But that's not possible, right?
Well, okay. Yes, of course it is, right? So because we didn't rule that out. I mean, it's normal for us to think of functions like the square root function, which won't be negative.
Yeah.
But there's nothing that says that, you know, as like in this case, right, that you couldn't say that, you know, one taco meal and one Thai meal gives you a negative 100. Right. And then if you had 2 and 2, it gives you a negative 90 because it gets bigger, right? You're monotonic. So as you get more, your utility improves. So you can have, you could have a utility function that gives negative values, but normally economists wouldn't do that just because, unless there was some real good reason, you know, you'd have to think about, but the only thing that, that our, you know, model requires, right, is that the consumer is rational. And then we, and which means in particular, they're monotonic, which means as they get more, their utility goes up. In this case, if it's a negative, it gets less negative. And that we added on this diminishing marginal utility. That's not rationality. This is well-behaved preferences. So it increases at a decreasing rate is the way that we would say that. So my point in talking to you about this, and I think we got it, and we're starting to run low on time, so I'll kind of head and wrap this up. So if I say to you on a scale of like 1 to 10, you know, if you get 1 and 1, remember we're going to go up from there. So you got to have to leave yourself room knowing that 10 is the best, right? So what would you say your utility is for being able to get Thai once a month and tacos once a month?
Let me see.
You can use a calculator.
Yeah, because why not?
Well, you don't really need a calculator, but okay.
I mean, it's going to be in the decimals, but I've been so reliant on the calculator that I can't do that.
Yeah, but if somebody walked up to you on the street and said on a scale of 1 to 10, how do you feel about it?
On a scale of 1 to 10, I guess I'd feel like 1.
Yeah. Okay. So that's fine. That's 1.
Oh, okay. I thought you wanted an actual calculation. I was like, I'm ready.
No, because I'm not saying this is your utility function. What I'm saying is that we can do this, but what we just did by me just eliciting your response, that's perfectly fine. It's just, it would be tedious to do that, you know, for every single consumer in every single situation, right? So, you know, and then if I say, okay, so suppose you get 1x and 2y, now tell me what your utility is. So now you've gone out to tacos twice.
1.25.
Okay, 1.25. So that's fine, right? It's a little bit higher, so it's increasing. Okay. So if we use a function instead, right, that just facilitates our analysis. So that's the reason why I did the whole like table thing. Now, if we said that your utility function actually looked like this, well then yeah, actually, right, it'd be the square root of 1 is 1, the square root of 1 is 1, and that gives us 1, right? 1 times 1 is 1. Right now, so now you probably want your calculator, but I'm going to make it easy, and I'm going to erase that and that and that, and I'm going to say, okay, suppose we have 2 and 2, then what would your utility be?
Are we using, is it just a
random? No, this is the actual utility function that we're choosing, which is this one.
Which is the one that's there, right? The point.
Yeah. So it's that one. Well, it's the square root of 2 times the square root of 2.
Oh my gosh, why am I doing this? Yeah, square root of 2, square root of 2.
Well, you don't have to know, but the square root of 2 times the square root of 2 is just
2. Yeah.
2. Yeah. Right.
I'm really out here just using a calculator. Sorry, it's too early to be doing math right now.
But. Yeah. Well, like I told you, math
under
works
pressure,
better.
Under pressure.
Yeah. So, anyways, but that's the way that you would do it, and like we'll just do one more really simple one, right? So suppose we do 4 and four.
It would be four.
Yeah. Then we get four. And if we do one and 16, we get, well, the square root of 16 is, and the square root of one is?
One, so four.
Four, right?
It took me a little bit, but I got there.
Yeah. So, and then 16 and one.
Would be four again.
Would be four. Okay. So these, the X and Y points, right? These are all, and see if you follow me here, because again, I got to wrap this up, but since we're deep into this, I kind of want to make my point. These are points in this XY plane. I'm going to use the one and one and the four and four. So what I mean by that is, that's like one X and one Y, right? Mm-hmm. And then the value of the utility, I would be plotting up in that direction, right? And likewise for here, we would have
there and there.
Yeah. Right.
And then up.
Yeah. And then this one would be plotted up here. And we'd end up with some sort of a surface up here. And so just give me 1 second. I just want to show you guys one thing before we go. And that is, okay. Okay, so, okay, and this is what they look like. These are the Cobb-Douglas utility functions. You guys can see these three-dimensional surfaces, right? Mm-hmm. And if we plot them down, this is, they have X1 and X2, and we had X and Y, they end up being these what we call contour plots in the two-dimensional surface where we have our consumption goods. So we'll come back to this next time, but I'll end there and I'll ask, does anybody have any questions about the stuff that we've talked about right now? Any questions?
I have a question about the assessment, not necessarily this.
Okay. Well, let me then...